So far we've been working with Boolean logic gates, which all have basically the same form. They take in one or maybe two bools, and then they output a bool. And so as we've seen, you can do a number of different things with this, and combining gates, you can build up all kinds of stuff. But it's also a little bit limited, in that we can only take in bools as inputs, and we can only output a bool. What if we want these Boolean gates to interact with other types in our system? And so to do that, we're going to think about what are called multiplexers. Multiplexers are kind of a generalization of logic gates, in that they have a little bit more of a function. And when we transport multiplexers into the context of homotopy type theory, they're going to correspond to a really important part of our type theory called iteration. So here's how a multiplexer works. On the top, it takes a Boolean input. So this can be either on or off. And of course, you can attach a whole Boolean circuit to do more complex logic. But I'm just going to draw it with the on-off switch attached. And then also attached to this multiplexer are going to be two terms of some type. So they could be like hola and hello, which are both terms of type string, or 7 and 5, which are both terms of type nat. Or they could be Booleans, so I could have Booleans going into this multiplexer. But whatever type these two things are, that is going to be the type of the output of my multiplexer. So I really want to stress this point, is that these two inputs, besides the Boolean input, they have to be of the same type, and that has to be the same type as the output of the multiplexer. Otherwise, this isn't going to work. And so how the multiplexer works is that if its Boolean input is on, then the output is going to be the first value. So here I have my first value is hola, my second value is hello, and if it's on, then the output is going to be hola. Whereas if the Boolean input is off, then the output of the multiplexer is going to be the second value. So here, hello. And that's it. That's all there is. Now, technically, electrical engineers work with more complex multiplexers, which maybe take in multiple Booleans and do other kinds of things, but this is all we're going to be thinking of. And so now let's do the corresponding thing in Agda. So the first thing to notice is that here on this line 38, I've declared a variable, a, which is just going to be some type. This is something you can do in Agda, that if you want to have something be a variable throughout, then you can just say variable a, and then give whatever type it's going to be a variable of. And so this type a is going to be the type of the two things that we're attaching to the multiplexer, and as well as the type of its output. So I'm not going to call this multiplexer. You see here in this comment that I call this bool iteration, and so I'm going to write this as iter-bool. Now, the reason it's called iteration doesn't make a lot of sense in this context, but when we do the analogous thing for numbers and other what are called inductively structured data types, then the reason this is called iteration will make more sense. So iter2, like our multiplexer, is going to require two terms of type A. So these are going to be the values that it's switching between. And then it'll take in the Boolean, so that's the input on the top. And then the final output is going to be whatever this type A is. And so I'll say iter 2, and I'll call the values A0 and A1. And again, I'm going to load this file with a goal, and then I'm going to case on B. And so as we saw with the multiplexer, when the Boolean input is on, then I'm going to pick A0, and when the Boolean input is off, I'm going to pick A1. And so let's play around with this. I'm going to switch to a different file called sandbox03, where I have imported this O1 simple TT so I can make use of iter bool. So first let's recreate our example with hello and hola from before. So I'm going to import the string library so I can make use of strings. And then I'm going to declare a hello word, which takes in a Boolean and returns a string. And what it's going to do is the Boolean it's going to take in is going to select whether we want English or Spanish. So I'm going to call this variable Español. And so it says on the right-hand side here that I need a string. And so I want this string to be a word that says hello, but if Español is on, then I want it to be hola, whereas if Español is off, I want it to be hello. And so I'm going to do that using iter. And so now, if I compute hello word with Espanol mode on, it's going to give me hola. Whereas if I do it with Espanol mode off, it'll give me hello. So I encourage you to trace through how iter2 works and its definition, and to see why this example behaves the way it does. Another thing we can do here is we can recreate our logic gates using just iter. So iter generalizes the idea of a Boolean logic gate. So I can define a not prime, which is going to have the same behavior as not. And I'll define not prime of b to be iter2 off on b. So if b is on, then this is going to select the first one and give us off, whereas if b is off, this is going to select the second one and give us on. And so this has the same behavior as the regular not. Similarly, we can do AND. Think for a second of what three arguments I need to give iter2 in order for this and prime to have the same behavior as our original and. So there's two ways of doing it. I'm going to do this as b1 off b2. So if we compute on gives us off. Why does this give us off? Well, because B2 was off, and so B2 here is the switching bit, and so it's going to select the second one, which was off. Whereas if they're both on, well, then B2 is on, and so iter bool is going to select the first of its arguments, and B1 here is also on, and so on and on is on. And so that's iteration with bools. So you note here in a comment I wrote bool iteration and bool computation. So these are two steps that we have to do whenever we're defining a new type, which we do in one go when we're doing it in Agda, but when we're doing it in the deductive system, these are actually separate rules. So let's go over that for Bool now. The iteration rule says that I can use iter bool to form terms. So if A0 is a term of type A, and A1 is a term of type A, and B is a term of type bool, then I can form iter bool of A0, A1, B as a term of type A. And so this is just exactly what we did in Agda. So that's the iteration rule, which says I can form this term. And I guess it's worth noting that I'm including here as an implicit premise that A is a type. So I usually won't write that. If ever I write A0 is a term of type A, then that implicitly says that A is a type. But if we want to be fully formal, you could do that. Okay, so the iteration rule says that I'm allowed to form this term, but it doesn't say anything about how iter bool actually works. In order to do that, I need the computation rules. And so there's two computation rules in this case, one for each of the Booleans. And the first one says that if I do iter bool of A0, A1, and on, then that's going to select A0. And so this corresponded to one line in our code. And then the other says the corresponding thing for off, that if the Boolean I give is off, then it's going to select the second thing, A1. And so this is the general shape in the deductive calculus of how we make these types useful, how we say how to use them, is we give an iteration rule and we give computation rules, which say how the iteration rule works. Now you remember I had this type definition checklist of all the things we need to do to define a new type. So the first ones were the formation rule and the introduction rule, which assert the existence of the type and specify how to introduce new terms of the type. And so the next one is called the elimination rule. We don't have all the tools we need to talk about elimination rules in general. In particular, we're going to need dependent types. So instead, we're doing a special version, the iteration rule. And what the iteration rule does, and what the elimination rule will eventually do, is specify how to use the terms of this type. And as mentioned, the computation rules give judgmental equalities that govern how the iteration or elimination rule works. And then finally, there's what are called congruence rules, which we're not going to pay much attention to because they're not very interesting. But if we were being fully formal, we do need to include them. And these are things like this, which says that if I have two judgmentally equal bools, that I'm going to get judgmentally equal results if I use them for iteration. And so a short way of saying this is that iteration respects judgmental equality. Again, this is the kind of property that we're going to just kind of take for granted, but it is useful to say. So to close this video, let me make one final note about the syntax. So a moment ago when I was doing this example of defining and prime in terms of iter bool, you might have found it a little bit unintuitive to try to figure out what these are doing, just because it requires you to keep track of what the first argument is, what the second argument is, and especially when these are Booleans, it can kind of get a little bit hard to make sense of. And so for that reason, a lot of programming languages have a nicer syntax for doing iteration with Booleans, and that's called the if-then-else syntax. So if-then-else is the same thing as iter-bool, just it takes its arguments in a different order. So iter-bool takes the two A's first and then the Boolean, whereas if-then-else is going to take the Boolean and then the A arguments. But notice that I'm doing this underscore thing, which means I'm going to infix it. So I'm not going to apply this like a function, like I did with iter2, but rather the Boolean is going to go between the if and the then, then the two A's are going to go between the then and the else, and then following the else, respectively. And so this is going to make for nice syntax. So this will allow me to write it as if Boolean, then this, otherwise this, or if then else. So if on, then I want a not. Whereas if off, if the Boolean I give is off, then I want to select the second one, a not a one. And so this will let me write things a little bit nicer. So let me define and again, this time using if then else. So I'll write if B1, then B2, else off. And so this is, I think, just a little bit more clear, that if B1 is on, then it's the same result as B2. If B1 is off, then the whole thing is off. So if that's more useful syntax for you, then good. Let me do one more involved example of this using natural numbers. So here I import the built-in natural numbers. And then what I do is I'm not going to go over the definition of this, but what I do is I define this operator less than bool. And so what this does is it takes two natural numbers, so two numbers, and it returns a bool based on whether the first one is less than the second one. And so I can do things like 7 less than 5, and it returns off because 7 is not less than 5. Whereas if I do 5 less than 7, it gives on because 5 is less than 7. Now, the reason I gave this a 2 subscript is to remind us that it returns a Boolean. Later on, what we're going to want to do is we're going to want to use our propositions as types mindset in order to think of 5 is less than 7, not as a Boolean, but as a type. But we'll get back to that. And so this allows me to define things like the maximum function. So maximum is going to take a number, another number, and it's going to return whichever of its two inputs was bigger. And so if I give max m and n, then I can write this really nicely as if m is less than n, then, well, if m is less than n, then n is larger. And so I want to return n. Otherwise, if m is greater than or equal to n, then I want to return m. And so I can say, what's the max of 5 and 7? 7. What's the max of 2 and a million? A million. So a simple example, but this shows some of the power of what we can do by iterating on a bool. But that's all. So that's all I'm going to say for Booleans for now. But later I'll give a more involved example of using this if-then-else construction and this Boolean-valued less-than operator on natural numbers in order to do a more elaborate computational example.